Hi friends, good evening once again, and for few it's maybe good morning. I'm Piali and I welcome you all to this webinar. Today we have Mr. Sanjay Kumar with us, who is an accredited Kanban trainer and Kanban coaching professional. Though Sanjay is famous for his passion about agile and lean software development practices, but many of us don't know Sanjay is a writer as well. And today, Sanjay will tell us about different Kanban metrics, which can help us in evolving our Kanban implementation continuously. So, Sanjay, over to you.
Hello, Piali, and hello, friends. I'll quickly start with my introduction. Even though Piali did talk a little bit about me, I'm an agile trainer and coach. I do training primarily through Eisenbridge. And these are some of the common trainings I do, or more popular ones, I would say. Lean Kanban certifications from Lean Kanban University, KMP1 and KMP2. Then I also do certified professional agile coach program, which is approved from IC Agile. It's called ICPACC. Besides that, I also do quite a bit of corporate trainings and coaching in Agile, Scrum, Kanban, and Scrumban. I've been experimenting with the different agile practices since 2006, so it's more than 10 years now. And before I moved on to this agile trainer and coach profile, which I started about 2.5 years back, I have had, you know, accumulated about 15 plus years of software development experience. Now, moving on to today's session, before we start, I would like to do a quick survey, two or three quick questions to understand the audience, and so I can, you know, customize the presentation for all of you. Piali, can you bring this survey on? Question one.
Yes, I'm just starting it. I have shared the poll result. Okay, I'm reading it out for you. 7% developer architect, 5% testing, 56% team lead, and 33% more senior.
Good. So it's mainly people who have been in some kind of leadership role and who have, I'm assuming that most of you must have been in the middle of, you know, or responsible for agile transition for at least one team. That's good. Let's move on to the next question, which is how much is your experience with Kanban? You can again keep it open for about a minute. So number one is you have used visual Kanban boards, but not beyond that. Second is, in addition to Kanban boards, you have also tried to use some kind of web limits, either column web limits or row level, you know, swim lane web limit. The third is you have also used the cumulative flow diagram metric, at least CFD. The fourth one is you have also used other metrics besides CFD.
Okay, I have launched the poll. So most vote is for the option A, I have used visual Kanban boards. Option B, have 36% vote, used WIP limits. Option C has 21% vote, cumulative flow diagram. Okay. And option D have 12% vote. Lead time distribution.
How much do we have for number one?
78%.
How much do we have on 78%? Okay, yes. Good. Good, now let's move on to number three. What kind of projects is Kanban suited for, in your opinion? All right, good. So this is very much in line with expectation. It's good to see that people have not selected the option number one much, which means that most of the people feel that Kanban can be used for IT projects. But the part C is one of the most common myths that we have in the industry, that Kanban is suited for operation support projects only. In my experience, I've tried to use Kanban for development projects also, and it has worked pretty well. And I'll show you, share some of the metrics from those projects also. And thanks again for all the participants for keeping the patience and answering these questions. It was just for me to understand the audience profile. And let's get started with the content of the presentation. Now, one thing I would like to say before I begin is Kanban in IT means Kanban method? Because there are some other terms, like most of the people believe that Kanban is just a board. There's what is there in Kanban. It's not that complicated. Now, of course, Kanban as a word in Chinese and Japanese means visualization, but Kanban, when you talk about IT, it has much more than visualization. And it has, Kanban method has six core practices. And now this Kanban method is what LKU, the Lean Kanban University, it has different programs, TKP, KMP1, KMP2, that focus on teaching people, participants about Kanban method. So Kanban method has six core practices, and number one of them is visualized work. So Kanban board is just one part, you can say, out of six core practices. Number two is limit work in progress. Number three, manage the flow. Make sure the flow is moving smoothly. And when you're managing flow, there are two key things we're trying to avoid. Number one is starvation. The other is bottlenecks. Bottlenecks might be pretty commonsensical that, you know, stuff gets, some work gets stuck in the flow. That is a bottleneck. The starvation is a case where people are available, resources are available, but the work is not for them. Basically, we're wasting resources. Number four is make policies explicit. Number five, implement feedback loops, something similar to Scrum ceremonies, but the names we have here is different. Number six is implement the idea of Kaizen, which is continuous improvement. Now, I will not have time to detail, you know, give the details of these six practices in this webinar, but if anybody has questions, please drop me a line, either on LinkedIn or maybe, I think, really for most of the participants must have come through Meetup also. Do we have option on the Discuss Agile page also about putting comments on this presentation? Pyali?
Me now?
Okay, looks like she's not.
Can you hear me now?
No, after the session.
Yes.
Do we have option on the Discuss Agile page to put comments?
Yes, yes. We will create a thread about this webinar, and any question, any comment, okay, they can come and post there. We will take care of it.
Okay, perfect, perfect. So asking to make sure, you know, if I have to provide some extra resources to people to read, I can share it over there. Sure. So one blog I'll share from David Anderson is where he talks about these six core practices and talks a little bit more about that. Now, if you see, let's compare different three commonly different terms which people understand from Kanban. Number one is Kanban board, that is just a visualization of your work. The other thing used is called Kanban system. Now the concept of Kanban system came up from Toyota production system, which was, I think, late 1940s. Now Kanban system is a bigger concept than Kanban board. You could roughly equate it to Kanban board plus the idea of having a pull mechanism where people pull work rather than work being pushed to them. Number three is implementing WIP limits. Now this concept is Kanban system, which was implemented in Toyota production system. Now I've seen many people who argue that Kanban in IT is same as Kanban system, which I believe it is not. And there comes in Kanban method, which is what we're talking about, which is more than Kanban system. It has other things like managing flow, and this involves active use of Kanban metrics. In addition to that, implement the idea of Kaizen, continuous improvement. Let's move on with benefits Kanban delivers. I'm just giving very brief summary to most people because some of you might be unaware of these things, and after that we'll quickly move on to the metrics part. Kanban delivers transparent and consistent process. So once we have visualization of work, it becomes very clear to people that, you know, whatever, how the work flows through the system, who is doing what work, how much work overall the entire team has, you know, committed to, all those things becomes very, very clear. Second is enabling a smooth flow of work. I'll give an example. I recently went to for coaching to a client, and there were several teams, and one of the team, which was a reporting team, they had about five developers who were working on reports. Now, after seeing that some other teams had implemented Kanban board, somebody thought, that, you know, why don't we create a board for ourselves? and they created a board. And after creating the board and putting all the work items on that, they quickly realized that they had 50 reports in progress. 50 reports for about five people. That looks like too much of work in progress. And this simple visualization helped them realize that, you know, how ineffectively they had been working. And within the next 2 or 3 days, they were able to finish 10 reports, bring down the work in progress to 40. And in another 2-3 days, they finished about 8 to 10 reports more. So bring it further down to about 30. Now, this is definitely a benefit, which you're talking about the benefits number 1 and 2. Now, even though it's a good benefit, this is not the complete power Kanban can give you. Kanban can also help you get other benefits like better predictability. And when I'm talking about predictability, I'm talking about predictability of throughput as well as lead time. It helps you balance demand with capability. It helps business be fit for purpose. So metrics especially help with the last 3 points, number 3, number 4, number 5. Without metrics, you might see some improvement, number 1, number 2, but you will not be able to take it further, you know, keep improving the system on and on. Now, which teams usually adopt Kanban? Because of the myth like, you know, Kanban is good only for support projects or Kanban is just a visual board, there is a prevalent myth that Kanban is good for support projects only. So those teams transition to Kanban. The second is those teams that you feel that transitioning to Scrum might be too much of a transition because it will require role changes and coming from waterfall to, you know, doing a 2-week sprint, which looks like too difficult for them. They might take an approach of, you know, transitioning to Kanban. Of course, somebody in there needs to be aware of what Kanban is. The third case is where people tried Scrum for development project and it did not work well. And I've written a blog on Kanban just 1 week or 2 weeks back, which talks about 3 most common dysfunctions or challenges new Scrum teams face. In the end, I'll also share my LinkedIn profile. So please feel free to connect with me and look at this blogs and some other blogs on Kanban. So out of these 3, number 1 and number 3 are the most common examples of why teams or when teams think of moving to Kanban. Now, as I mentioned previously, that initial success phase is quickly achieved within a month or two, where team just uses a visualization board to track their work. And they see better transparency, workflows smoothly, and the collaboration improves. Collaboration between developers and testers primarily, plus also collaboration between the business and also the development team. It also improves. After this initial success phase, usually there is sort of a plateau where, you know, the team feels that, yes, we have done it. You know, everything is going fine. They don't feel the need to continuously improve or improve any further. And that's the big challenge. And what you're missing if you do not move to more mature implementation of Kanban is you do not have enough predictability and you do not have that culture of continuous improvement. Now, as I mentioned, that's where we need metrics. And why do we need metrics? I strongly believe that it's difficult to improve something that is not being measured. So if you're not measuring your flow, how effective your flow is right now, it will be difficult to improve that. So basically an inertia or complacency sets in. Let's quickly move on to, we'll talk about 4 different metrics in Kanban. Number 1, which is the most popular, is cumulative flow diagram. Then we'll talk about control chart. Then we'll talk about lead time distribution. And number 4 will be throughput chart. Throughput chart will be very similar to velocity chart. Now, cumulative flow diagram is the most common or most famous, I would say, metric. The reason could be that most of the tools like Jira, which do not support other Kanban metrics, they at least give you this particular metric. cumulative throughput diagram. What it shows is how many items have crossed a particular point in the flow. And when you talk about how many items, you're talking about cumulative number, items so far. Let's look at one example board before looking at a simple cumulative flow diagram. So I'll pause here and allow you to take a look at this board. It's a very simple board. Now, this ready column on the left is not the backlog. Backlog would be on the left of this. Ready is the items that you're committed to. Very similar to how you pull 5-6 items in the beginning of a sprint. Those are the committed items. So every week, a Kanban team usually pulls some items from backlog and puts them in ready. It means the team has committed to start working on it. And then you have this is one particular team's board. Your team does not need to be exactly same. All right, so this is the sample board, and given this particular board, and this is actually a board coming from one of the team I've been coaching for the past 3 months. This is a cumulative flow diagram for a particular time period for the same team. Now let me tell you, quickly explain what are these numbers. Right. So this is x-axis, as you see, is the date starting from 1st June to 23rd June, roughly about a month. And as the legend at the bottom tells you, the black line talks about how many items you are committed to. Right. Let's take an example of 9th June. So if you see 9th June, the total number of items committed so far is 24, this point. And then you have total number of items that where the design has been completed is 19, which is this. Total number of items where backend work has been completed is 16, then it is 12, and then it is, now the light green and dark green, those lines are merging at this point, which means that there is no work in progress in UAT. Right? I'll pause a little bit here to let you try to understand this cumulative flow diagram. It might look a little complex, but once you understand one single point, then it becomes very easy. Now, this cumulative flow diagram is telling us the history for about 20-25 days of, you know, how much work is at what stage. Now, the question that comes is, all right, it's telling us, you know, different positions or different status of work items, but what is the value? Can you see any problems over here? So one problem is this zone, you can say, this zone, you see there's too much work in progress. The gap between two lines shows how much work is in progress. And this gap shows number of items where the front-end work has been completed, the red line, but testing has not been completed yet. So if you look at date number 7th of June, you see the difference between red line and green line is about 8 items. So 8 items are pending testing. Either the testing has not started or they are in progress. Two white lines means too much work in progress. On the other side, you see over here where the two lines have sort of, they're touching each other. They have come very close, which is a possibility of starvation. Right. This means that the testers do not have work on this particular date. And even before that, the previous day also, there was only one item which was pending testing. So when lines touch or get too close to each other, it shows the possibility of starvation. When the lines becomes too wide apart, it shows the possibility of a bottleneck, that the work has stopped moving. It is accumulating. And that's the really real beauty of cumulative flow diagram. You can track and you can see what kind of dysfunction in the flow is creeping in. Right. The other dysfunction you see is in this area, where from 14th June to about 22nd June, where you see the green line has almost become flat. That means no work is being finished in these 6-7 days, only one item has been finished. Otherwise, the line is basically flat, which means that for some reason, either there are too many people who are on leave, or they got stuck with something, or some other external intervention has come in, the throughput of the team has slowed down quite a bit. So this shows you the running summary of how the team has been performing and how the flow has been going on. Okay. Let me show you another example of CFT for another team. As I mentioned, when the two lines are wide apart, that shows this high in-process inventory, too much work in progress, which could be a possibility of bottleneck. This running summary, but you can also compare the cumulative flow diagram of two different releases once you have accumulated enough data. For example, this is the two cumulative flow diagrams of the same team across two releases. So the release, the graph on the top is, let's say, release one. Now for this team, they were releasing the product every quarter. So the top one is, let's say, quarter number one, and the second one is quarter number two. You can see, you can compare this to cumulative flow diagram, and it makes it very, very easy to say, one can confidently say that the team has improved from quarter one to quarter two. The flow of work has become much streamlined, much leaner flow. Even though they had some problem here in the beginning, where they resorted to old style of working and they ended up pulling too much work, but then they realized in time that, you know, the work in progress is increasing. So let's not commit too much work, let's minimize our work in progress and have a more, you know, leaner flow. The other thing you would see is the bottom line, this line is pretty straight, which means there's a very sustainable pace the team has come to. Compared to the quarter one, where this throughput line, it became almost flat. Pierre, do we have any questions? Maybe, yeah, I'm thinking of pausing for about 5 minutes on any questions on only CFT, cumulative flow diagram.
Just let me check. No, not specific about CFT. We have two questions. So one is about Scrumban, when to choose. And another one we have is for development work, can you share same thoughts when you would choose Scrum or XP and when you would choose Kanban? So it would be some thoughts. Okay. Can you share some thoughts on when you would choose Scrum or XP and when you would choose Kanban?
So I'll keep it for the end because this webinar is purely about Kanban metrics. So I'll give reference to Kanban metrics questions. And I'll come to this question maybe in the end.
Sanjay, we have got three questions about CFT just now. So first we have is CFT, what is the ideal duration or it can be applied anywhere?
Okay, so CFT is an ongoing curve. The duration depends on if you have a continuous flow of work, like, you know, you can just keep doing it, or you have a concept of releases, like I shared this example of release one, release two. So it will be an ongoing graph, but you can reset it at the end of each release.
Okay, one more we have. Can we check CFT for Scrum?
CFT in Scrum will not make sense because, as I mentioned, when lines get too close or touch each other, that shows starvation. And Scrum is a batch process framework. It basically, you pull work for a sprint and then you try to finish everything. So if you create a cumulative flow diagram for Scrum, it'll all the lines will sort of merge at the end of the sprint, and again they will open, and again merge, and again open. So it's not a continuous flow, it's a batch flow. It will make more sense where you do not have a time box like sprint. Gary, next.
Yeah. How the commitment line is related to the delivery in the CFT?
Commitment line is related to delivery.
Yep.
So the commitment line is more about committing to start the work. It's not necessarily commitment to deliver on a particular date. In case of a continuous flow, the work keeps coming from the left-hand side and the keys going out from the right-hand side. If you have a concept of release, then it may happen just like it shows in these graphs, that towards the right, all the lines, they merge and almost in the flow basically emptied because whatever you committed to, you finished everything. This is a release phase thing. But if you imagine a team which is doing continuous deployment, which keep pulling work and keep finishing work, they could have a cumulative flow diagram where all lines sort of keep going on and on and on without getting too close or getting too wide apart. So the distance between the lines, they need to maintain a healthy distance. It should not be too wide. It should not be too close. Anything else?
Yeah, we have few more questions. If you wish, I can read out now, or we will take care of it later.
Particularly on CFT, I would like to clarify those questions before I move on.
Okay. So next we have: how often do you review CFT and replan the work?
So CFT, you look at it every day, and it's not a planning tool. It's more of a health indicator, you can say. Health indicator, plus it also shows you a warning sign, sort of, you know, what is going on. Now, the same thing is also visible on the board. CFT is creating a history of what happened from time to time. So if you look back at your CFT, you can see, you know, we are seeing this issue because we have not been able to take care of the issue for a long time. So anybody who's looking at the board every day, the team member or, you know, team lead, CFT is a running, or you can say historical data of how the board or how much work was on the board with time. So you keep looking at it every day. It might be more important when you do analysis of how you performed as a team in the past 1 month or quarter. And also very important to metric if you want to show it to management about, you know, how effective as a team you have been doing. Kelly, I think I should move on.
Okay. Yeah.
8:35. I'll quickly go through other metrics. When I was creating this presentation, I was sensing that there might be too much stuff for 1 hour, but I'll try to finish all the metrics at this might skip one or two slides, but I think that should be fine. Control chart. Control chart is also called drawing chart. It shows you how the lead time is varying over a period of time. Now, let me clarify what lead time is. Lead time is a terminology used by LKU. They do not use the term cycle time, but some people might be aware of cycle time. For this presentation, you can assume lead time and cycle time are the same thing. Now, lead time starts when you commit. So as soon as an item comes on the board, the timer starts on that item. And once it exits the flow on the right-hand side, exits means not necessarily in production, but the team is done with it. If the team is responsible for QA only, then as soon as QA is done, you would say the team is done with it. So you would calculate this lead time. The term LK uses is called system lead time, which is same as you can say cycle time. Now, for one item, you have that difference between when it was done to when it was committed. That difference in time, elapsed time, is lead time, system lead time, or lead time for that item. So if you keep, let's say a team has lead time of roughly, let's say, over here, little bit of variation is over here. Somewhere over here, you effected some change. And after that, your lead time either could start going up or maybe it could start going down. If the lead time is going up, that means that the change was not effective. Because lead time, a shorter lead time is a better thing. A shorter lead time means once you commit to the business, within how much time you can get done with an item. Of course, the business would like, or even you would like to do it faster, which means that this is a better scenario. The change really worked for you compared to this case where the change probably did not work for you. Let me show you an example of a real control chart from one of the team. Now, The x-axis is the date. So if you see this particular date, which is June 14th, on June 14th, you have three items, one, two, three items. Three items were done by the team. And the y-axis is the lead time. So for the first item, you had a lead time of about 9. The second and third, you had lead time about 60 or 62. Right? So you plot all this thing. It shows you a scatter diagram kind of thing. Now, it might be confusing at the first sight. Now, this is from a team which started their project or the release in March, mid-March or March beginning. But they were working on too many items, but they were not finishing an item. Somewhere in the beginning of June, they started implementing Kanban. And within the next 1 week or 10 days, they finished lots of items. So the items you see on the left-hand side, these were most of the items were started more than 2 months back. That's why this lead time of more than 50, 60 days. If you see the overall pattern of how the lead time has been happening, you could see a downward trend towards lead time. In the beginning, there was too much high variation, but somewhere over here, you can confidently say the lead time is well controlled within 20 days. Now, this is 20 working days. Somewhere down, even though there are exceptions, you could possibly say that lead time has come down to about 15 days, which shows the effectiveness of the team. With time, they are improving their discipline of finishing the work faster, even though there are exceptions where they could not do a good enough job, but they are slowly becoming better in finishing, you know, finishing the work faster. Now I'll move on to lead time distribution. So in the previous, the x-axis was the date done when the item was completed, and the y-axis was lead time. In lead time distribution, it's slightly different. The lead time is on the x-axis, and y-axis is number of items with that particular lead time. So this is more for cumulative summary. So you would possibly do it, let's say, for few weeks or maybe for a month, that for that particular month, whatever number of items were done by the team, how does the lead time look like? You may have a lead time like this, which means that these many items had a lead time of this much and like that. So usually you could have a tail. A tail means that many of the items are taking too much time. Right. Let me show you a real life lead time distribution. This is again a real life data from coming from a team. So if you look at this number, it says there's one item with a lead time of 16 days. So it took 16 days. There are five items with a lead time of 17 days. This is a curve which is very sort of spread out, which does not show good predictability by the team. As you see on the right, there are so many items that take not just weeks but months, which is not a good indicator of the team's effectiveness. You could roughly create a shape like this here, which is a long, long tail compared to how a better cumulative for lead time distribution might look like. Yeah, so this is a typical cumulative lead time distribution. If you look at a lead time distribution, and let's say you want to improve, of course a team wants to improve month after month, release after release. If you have two lead time distributions, how would you say that your lead time distribution has improved? So the first thing is you would like to make it more closer. So a tall and narrow lead time distribution is better than a flat and wide, right? So this is a better lead time distribution than this one. The second improvement opportunity is you move the entire curve to the left-hand side, meaning items are taking less amount of time in getting done. The third improvement opportunity in a lead time distribution is either slim the tail or you cut the tail. Cutting the tail means no item takes more than X number of days. which could have been a case if you go back here, if the team had not, if let's say these items were not here at all, these items, if all items were done within 15 days, which means that the lead time distribution would not have a tail. It will not have this particular tail. Now let me show you some lead time distribution, again coming from a different team. This is a release one lead time distribution. If you see, this looks very flat. A flat lead time distribution means it has very less predictability, meaning if business gives you an item, if business gives a request to the team, a story, they don't have any predictability how much time it will take, because based on this lead time distribution, it could take anywhere from 1 or 2 days to 45, 46 days. There is hardly any predictability. Now this team was able to improve their performance quite a bit in one quarterly release. Their 85th percentile, which is this line, it came from 26 days to 17 days. What 85th percentile means is that we are confident we can finish, or based on our historical data, we were able to finish 85% of the items within 26 days. Same thing here. In release 2, the team was able to finish 85% of the items within 17 days. So it's an improvement of about 9 days. The same team improved it further. I think this 17 days came down to about 11, 12 days. Now, this shows you an example of how to lead time distribution. If you look at them, how do you make out, you know, if it is improved or it is still the same, or it has maybe, you know, become bad. The same team, going from release 2, quarterly release 2 to quarterly release 3, they were further able to improve the lead time distribution. Now you see the shape. The shape is much better. The data is more concentrated. And if you see the number of items here, this is 30 compared to the peak of only 9. Right, so this is a more tall and narrow, even though it doesn't look that tall here, but it's more condensed, the data is more condensed, and the tail, even though it is long tail still, going up to 41 days, but the width of the tail has narrowed down. So you can say you have slimmed the tail here. And of course, the 85th percentile has also improved from 17 days to 12 days. Now, this is the kind of improvement, you can say it's improvement evidence that team has improved, and there's a clear measurable evidence. And generally I've seen management loves this kind of stuff, because in many cases the management says we went for agile, but we are not sure if the team is doing good or not. So if you are able to do these kind of metrics, whether you're doing Scrumban or Kanban, you can go back to the management and say, you know, there's a clear evidence that we have been improving release after release or month after month. The last one is throughput chart. I think I should be able to wrap it up in next 3-4 minutes, so leaving about 10 minutes for questions and answers. Now throughput chart is very similar to your velocity chart. It shows how the throughput is varying. Oh, by the way, I should explain what is throughput. Throughput is number of items done in a particular week. Now, a development team would probably use per week measure, but a support team, which is doing, let's say, 20, 30 items per day, they might use a throughput chart where they calculate the throughput per day. And this is a real-life throughput chart. It shows you week number. Now, it doesn't show you the date, but week number, you can say the week of the year. So 23rd will be somewhere around May, I would say. This shows week after week how many items the team is finishing. As you can see here, there's not enough consistency here. There was sort of some consistency here. If these 3 and 4, the team was not able to finish enough items here, which led to an increase over here. So basically, too many items which accumulated, they were done here. But if this 9 was maybe 7 and this 3 or 4 were maybe 4 and 5, it show more consistent throughput. But this is what it is. This is how the team has been performing. And you can look at these and take it to the, I usually take this kind of charts to the team in the retrospective or what you call service delivery review in Kanban method, and just show it to them and ask them, you know, what do you make sense of this? You know, what thing is happening? And they themselves realize that, you know, our velocity or our throughput is not sustainable, it's not predictable. There's quite a bit of variance and we need to do something about it. And as an agile coach, I will say, if you can, without saying much about, you know, the team's performance, if you can make the team realize about what's going on and, you know, have an initiative coming from the team, there's nothing like it. I mean, more than 50% of your job is done. All right. So this is the summary of the different Kanban metrics we have done. And now it's time for questions. I'll leave my personal details slide here while I answer the questions. Yeah, Piali?
Yeah, we have a lot of questions here. Let's see how much we can take care of. So here I can see a question. Is the sprint duration a week in Kanban?
There's no sprint in Kanban, it's continuous flow. When I mentioned that you pull work every week, that is more of a replenishment meeting. That's only for to decide how many items can be pulled into the flow. The flow never gets empty. In Kanban, when you have a sprint, you empty the entire flow, you finish all the stories, then you pull another batch. So Scrum is a batch flow, but Kanban is a continuous flow. The work remains in the flow all the time. There's no sprint.
Okay, moving to the next one. Referring Kanban board, lead time is measured for which column?
Lead time is for the entire flow. Let me go back to the board. If you have this particular board, so lead time starts when an item enters the flow. So in this case, the lead time starts over here and it goes on until this point. So from entry over here to exit over here, when an item exits this particular line, you will say, you will calculate the lead time. So this is the end time and this is the start time. We just take a difference of this end and start time and find the lead time. Yeah, Kelly, next.
Yeah, next we have, is there any guideline for setting up WIP limits?
Oh, that's going to take more than half an hour, maybe 15, 20 minutes. That's a complete question. It's a very common question that comes up in KMP1 class, Kanban Management Professional class. The shortest answer is it's empirical in nature. So you have to try some things and you see how it's working for you and you try minimizing it if it's working fine. Yeah, that's the short answer.
Okay, so moving on to the next, we have defects or stories blocked. Does it get counted in lead time?
See, lead time is for each individual item. So if a story was committed pulled into the ready column and let's say it got stuck somewhere over here, right? It is still part of the flow. It is still in the flow. And when stories get stuck for whatever reason, it could be defect or it could be external dependency, the lead time of the story will increase. And that's where it shows you, you know, as a team, when you're looking back at your lead time distribution, you'd often, you know, these items which are contributing to the tail over here, these are the items which have taken too long. And it could be different reasons. So as a team, in your retrospective or service delivery review, you should look at these items. Why are they taking too long? Are there any patterns of, you know, delays in the system, like waiting for XYZ team, or the defects are being overlooked, or there's too much of rework happening? So the tail will give you improvement opportunities in case of Kanban. Yeah, next.
Yeah, next we have, how can we configure the throughput chart in tool like Jira?
Jira should give you, I don't recall seeing, with most of the teams what happens is if they're using Jira, they can see the CFD in there, But for most teams, I need to ask them to give me the data in Excel, take it from Jira, and I quickly create those Excel, the charts in Excel. I do it once, and then I tell them how to do it themselves. So it's a, yes, extra work. I would say I wish that Jira had better support for Kanban metrics. Unfortunately, not. The two most popular tools which have the best support for Kanban metrics is number one, Swift Kanban from Digite. The second one is Kanbanize. These two are the best tools which have support for most of the Kanban metrics. Jira, unfortunately, does not. Next.
Yeah, next we have why it is called control chart in Kanban. As we are not using mean, upper limit, and lower limit, we are using this as display chart.
I don't know the history of naming convention, but it's also called run chart. And I guess it's called run chart because it shows you the running summary of how, with time, how the lead time distribution, lead time looks like. So it's run chart and control chart.
Okay, so next we have, can Kanban be suitable for larger projects?
Larger means how much? But let me just answer it based on my experience. I worked with teams which are about, which have 30 members in a single team, and Kanban works worked perfectly for them. In fact, some of the metrics I showed, where it had release one, release two, release three, that was from that team only. Now, Kanban is naturally scalable. It gives you options of how to configure your different teams. But some of you might be aware that Safe uses Kanban a lot. But at most of the upper layers, it uses Kanban board, the visualization part only. I'm yet to see a Safe team that is using Kanban at the lowest level, at the team level, and they're using the Kanban metrics and everything else. But yes, Kanban is naturally scalable, and it's easily scalable for up to 50 people. You could have multiple teams. If let's say a program, you could have one program level board, and then you have individual team level boards, or you could have different siblings for different teams on one single board. Kari, next.
Yeah, next we have, in Kanban, is testing not happening in parallel? Sample Kanban board shows step-by-step activity.
So this is one particular team, and you, when you talk about this flow, it's more about each item is going to flow here independently. So it really happens that the testing and development is happening at the same time for the same item. The only exception is when testers are creating test cases. So for this team, what we, the understanding was, you know, we had customized their cart, item cart, and if a tester was creating test cases while an item was in let's say backend development, we had some visualization to note that down, right? But usually an item moves from left to right, and it's sequential in nature. Some teams that do backend and frontend together, they could have a column called development, not necessarily backend and frontend separate, but one column development. And on the item card, people could, you know, put notes of who did what and started what date. All those things can be customized. Pierre, next.
Yeah, next we have, how do we make sure that Kanban does not follow the waterfall methodology?
Kanban does not follow.
Yeah, the waterfall methodology.
You have continuous flow of work. See, some people look at this flow of, you know, the columns, they believe that it's like waterfall. Now, even in Scrum, you do development before testing or design before development. So the sequence of activities is not necessarily waterfall. What is waterfall is that you let the entire project, your say 50 stories, the entire 50 stories go into analysis and design. Then all 50 stories, the batch goes to backend development, then frontend, then testing and UAT. So it's how much work is flowing through from left to right that determines if it is waterfall or Scrum or Kanban. In Kanban, each item flows independently from left to right. In Scrum, each batch of 5 to 8 stories goes from left to right. Right, so if you have continuous flow of work, you're replenishing every week, you're finishing items every day, every other day, then it's not waterfall, I would say. Next, Kelly.
Yeah, next we have, which tool is best used to generate CFD?
So, I would say if the tool supports CFD, and that this should be fine. So, Jira does, most of the tools which have support for Kanban board, they give CFD. The challenge is with other metrics. They do not give lead time distribution or control chart. That's the sad part. And I did mention Swift Kanban and Kanban Ice are the most mature tools. So I'll take two more questions and then I will close. Is it fine, Thierry?
Yeah, sure. Okay, next we have, how do we identify blockers using CFD?
So CFD cannot display everything you have. You cannot display blockers using CFD. Blockers are on the board. What you could possibly do is, if you have too many blockers on some items, some typical blockers, they might contribute to the tail of the lead time distribution. So it's a good idea to identify why do you have a tail in the lead time distribution, what are the common reasons, and then discuss with the team in retrospective. Last one.
Yeah, so the last question, in Kanban, do we have frequent demos? In what frequency? Just a second, I lost the question. In what interval will they be planned?
So Kanban is more about flow of work, flow execution of work. Kanban method has some cadences, feedback loops. They do not have a demo, so their focus is if you need demo, you do it whenever you want. So just because you're using Kanban method and you find value in demo, it doesn't mean that because it is not there in Kanban method, you should not do it. It's more about what the team feels right. So you need a demo, you do it once in 2 weeks, once in 3 weeks. I would say the better decision maker would be talk to your business, talk to your customer. When would they like to have a demo? And decide based on that. All right. I would like to show one last slide, Piali, before you close. It's 8:59.
Yeah, sure.
So I have three KMP training schedule in the next roughly 2 months. The Bangalore one is actually this weekend. It might be too late for some of the participants, but if you can, please feel free to join in. Then I have a training in Hyderabad, KMP1. In KMP1, it's a two-day training. We talk those metrics and other stuff in much more detail, and we also discuss different case studies. The Hyderabad one is scheduled in November 4th and 5th, again Saturday and Sunday. And the next Bangalore batch will be on December 9th and 10th in case somebody is interested in learning more about Kanban method and, of course, learn about the Kanban matrix. Gary, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Sanjay. It was really an insightful session. And thanks, everybody, for joining in. And, as Sanjay shared, we do have KMP1 and, KMP2 classes as well, scheduled in major cities of India like Bangalore. We have Delhi, Hyderabad, Chennai and Pune. So whoever is interested, you can visit the training section of eisenbridge.com or just drop an email to us at sales@eisenbridge.com. So we will be more than happy to help us about our upcoming programs if you're interested in knowing more about Kanban.
One last point, if you have any question which was not answered or you have further questions, please post that question on the thread PLU was talking about. It's going to be on discussagile.com, right?
Yes, we will share the recording, SEU, PDU information. All the informations will be on one thread only. We will be sharing the link, and any question you have, just go and put the question there, and Sanjay can take care of the question.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
That's all for today. Thanks once again, everybody, for joining. Thanks, Sanjay. Have a great evening.
Thanks, Kali. Thanks, everyone. Good night, guys. Bye.
Good night.